conversations on social issues. My name is Kimberly Tate. I'm one of the reference and instruction librarians here. So thank you for joining us. We host this series every week of the quarter, except for the first and last, because we see it as an extension of our charge, promote freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. We want everyone to have access to a wide range of perspectives and viewpoints brought to us by the wisdom and passion of our faculty, staff, students, and community members. So, if you're interested in learning more about this topic after the session, we have a couple of resources from the library. We can find you some more. If you have any suggested resources for us, come talk to me. So we love having students, especially. So if you are a student and are passionate about a topic and would like to speak at COSI, let me know and we can get you on the schedule for fall. Just now, all right? At the end of this, I'll be asking you to fill out a very brief survey to tell us what worked well, how we can improve, and how we can keep this relevant for you. Next week, former council member Nick Licata will be hosting a session titled See the World You Want to Live In, You Can Make It Happen. But today, please join me in welcoming Anna Ewing, a BAS student here at Seattle Central College and a DSS staff member. So without further ado, Anna.
Able-bodied privilege today, which includes a variety of things. I'm going to talk about microaggressions, ableism, possibly language, and go over the sheet that I gave. So first, we should define privilege. It's not just all the rich people that everybody hates because they take all our money. It's any benefit or advantage that is unearned that only is allotted to one particular group. So we're probably more familiar with these privileges, white privilege, that the white race is more superior to the other races. White people are, it makes it easier for them to get a job. They're not attacked by police, things like that. Male privilege, men are paid at a higher rate than women. Heterosexual privilege, you don't have to be as straight. Class privilege, that I talked about just recently, that the more money you have, the more status you have, the more privileges you have. Christian privilege is the dominant religion here. If you are a Christian, then you're not considered a terrorist, most likely. Education privilege, while you can earn your education and go get a degree and you're more likely to get a job, it's a privilege just to be here right now, to have access to education. So able-bodied privilege, meaning that you're not disabled. This is also should be noted that it's temporary. You might not be born with a disability, but it's a minority that everyone will be a part of unless you die first. So 20% of the population has a disability currently, but you will become part of that 20% eventually. Passing privilege, so if you look white, then you can pass as white and have that privilege. If you look able-bodied, you can pass as able-bodied and have all the privileges that unlock that. It's also important to note that all of this is socially conferred. Society tells us what privilege we have and why it's important. So society tells us that if you are not disabled, then you have more privileges and more advantages. So all these privileges lead to the isms. We have sexism, where men are more superior than women. So racism, the divide in races. It's considered more acceptable to be white. Classism, or the divide in money status, low income, middle class, things like that. And ableism. So ableism is the oppression against people based on what they can or cannot do with their minds or their bodies. So the divide in able-bodied versus disabled. So we should also note that society keeps telling us that what disabled people can or can't do. So when society tells us that people with learning disabilities can't go to school, then that's what society believes. Form of ableism is microaggressions. The these are just the little implicit slights that you hear throughout the day. I will give you some examples. So I got together with a big group of disabled people to give me all their examples. Oftentimes, wheelchair users will be told to stop speeding, stop racing. While it seems real funny, it's not. That when you keep hearing that as a wheelchair user, it's like that's all you're good for. So I am disabled. And oftentimes when I divulge that to people, they say, oh, well, you don't look disabled. So what does disabled look like? You're saying that disabled looks bad? I also have a disability in which I get fatigued very easily. So even from my roommate, she says, you know, you're exhausted from what? Why are you so tired? Why you say that? Tired is different for everybody, regardless if they have a leg disability. So there's no reason to bring that up and put it against me. That kind of goes along with, oh, you sleep all the time and you don't have to work. Everybody's ability is different, regardless of their diagnosis. Many times on the bus, I have been trying to be saved. Somebody pulls out a Bible and tries to save poor little me because I can't see. I just laugh every time, but it gets really tiring because what they're saying is that I'm broken, that I need to be fixed. I'll notice that I have passive privilege when I pull this up. Along with being saved, and everybody sees my cane, they offer solutions for me. Well, have you tried this vitamin? Because that'll fix your sight. It's my disability. Pretty sure I know how to handle it, and I've spoken to many doctors. And a vitamin D pill is not what they've subscribed. So, oftentimes I hear students or particularly young people say, so what would the worst disability to have? What would the worst one be to have? What would the easiest one be to have? Not one disability doesn't trump the other. One isn't easier than the other. We all have barriers that we have to overcome in society. So backhanded comments, they sound nice, but really you are offending the entire population of that disability. You speak really well for being deaf. What you're really saying is that deaf people don't speak well, period. I heard this last week. She walks really well for a blind person. What does that mean? Blind people don't walk well? You're too pretty to be blind. Really, that's saying that blind people are ugly. You're too young to be blind. So according to them, no one is born blind. I have heard this. I would do her if she wasn't in a wheelchair. So that means that all people in wheelchairs are asexual or they're not worthy of having sex. From a woman who was born without legs. Did you lose your limbs in the war? She was only 18. She got this comment. And oftentimes people will ask her when her legs are going to grow back, as if she's a lizard and her tail is going to grow back. She's also asked when she's going to get her prosthetics. Why are you assuming that she needs prosthetics? She functions just fine without legs. And you're saying that to be normal, you should have legs. When people ask sign language users to teach them swear words. That is saying that all they're good for is to learn the swear words that are funny. Oftentimes, I hear children asking their parent, why does she use that stick? Or why does she walk that way? And the parent just shushes them and smacks them on the head. All that does is create more adults who are ignorant and who are going to use microaggressions. Children can ask questions. It's normal. And it's helpful. It's how they learn. They're born as a blank slate, and we teach them what to think. Why are these important? You might think some of them are funny, but they cause real harm to the receivers. As someone with a disability, hearing these nonstops just makes me start to think that I am less worthy, and I am worthy of all these comments.
So, let's see if you have privilege.
So if you haven't already, take a second to check off the list as you, in the you column, check off the sentences that apply to you. I'm going to pass out some simulators. Don't put them on yet. I'll just be there for a minute. So go ahead and put your glasses on, your simulators. If you wear glasses already, they can just go over top of them. Go ahead, take one, pass it down. Yes, do you have a question?
County.
Take the test with your simulators on. Sorry if I didn't tell you. You have one more minute? All right, time's up. Take your simulators off. Nice. So how did that go?
Not well.
But we just learned the material, and there are only four questions. Come on, guys. So I do this activity because many times somebody out there has my vision, and I'm just handed a paper for the class without any electronic version, so my computer can read it to me, even though it's an accommodation. So as teachers, I want you to understand that it's really important to make all the materials accessible to me so I'm on the same level as every other student. And as students, I want you to know that when I get extra time on a test, it's not cheating. It's so that I have the time to read the same test you have. It's really about equity, giving you the same chance that everybody else has for all types of disabilities. So now, I want you to go through that checklist as someone with the vision of the simulator you just were wearing. So don't put the simulator on, otherwise you can't do the checklist. Just try to think as that person. Would you have the privileges on that sheet? So when you finish, go ahead and write the total in that little box at the end. So did you guys have more or less privileges as a disabled person?
More.
Did someone say more?
Yes, I said more.
Yeah? Okay. Do you consider yourself an able-bodied person on the new side?
Yes.
Okay. Would you like to explain why you had more as the visually impaired person?
Sure. well, I, you know, my eyesight's not great. It's very, it's much better than this. So I can see the world around me. I can navigate. I can see whether, you know, just to sort of touch on a couple of questions, I can see if there's danger. I can, you know, keep my eyes open on the situation, potential danger. I can do things for myself, basically. I have total mobility and sight do things.
Right.
I am part of a group, however, that has been gravely discriminated against, so I can check that off as
right.
Sometimes I am asked to speak for all people of my group. But otherwise, you know, I lead a pretty privileged life. I can get around and do things.
Right. So you are still oppressed in some way.
Yeah.
Because you're part of that group.
Yeah.
Correct.
But not part of that group, part of another group.
Part of another group.
Yeah,
right.
Not part of that group, which group. Yeah.
That makes sense. Why does this matter? So I want you guys to start acknowledging and becoming aware of the privilege you have. Because as disabled people, we are less privileged, and we need your help. So stand in your place of privilege so that you can have a voice for people who are disabled. So when you hear the microaggressions or the ableism occurring, all it takes is just one voice to let the person who is doing it or the institution who's doing it understand that. Typically they don't know. They don't know the microaggression they just said or the fact that this school doesn't have a ramp to the cafeteria. Okay, they do know that. It's just not that important to them. But it's a very large form of ableism. And if enough people start to talk about that, then something will be done. So be an ally for those who are disabled. Like to touch on language now? So that is also microaggressions, and these words will be microaggressions, but language, it's really the values and beliefs that we have and the implicit values and beliefs that society has told us to have. So, person-first language is really something that able-bodied people think is the best way to go. This means that you should put the person first before their identifier. So, instead of flying person, the person who's blind, the person who's visually impaired. However, a large part of the disabled community likes their identifier. Being disabled is part of them, just like being a woman is part of me. You wouldn't say that I'm a human who is female. You would say woman or white woman. So why not say white woman? I hear this a lot from people who are have less visual disabilities, so people with learning disabilities, because there's no stigma attached to it when you look at them. But being disabled is part of me. So at what point do you stop putting the identifier with the person? Do you not add the race? So black woman, should we not say that anymore? Should we not say white woman? This is sort of a politically correct theory here. Political correctness was brought about for good purposes, but it often goes a little too far. Usually done by people who are in privileged categories. So I would suggest just asking people how they want to be referred to. Really not your place to choose. So ask the person if they want to be identified as the white person or the white blind person or anything like that. Mental health. It's a big one. Use all of these phrases every day. Let's start with crazy. I just said crazy an hour ago because I didn't want to have two different sized paper clips on my paper. That just bothers me. I happen to be OCD. I happen to have OCD. But I said, no, I can't have those two paper clips. I said this out loud to somebody. That would be just crazy. So really, I have identified all people with mental health issues as crazy. And use those sentences every day. So we go on to OCD that I just did. As a person with OCD, I find it okay. But when people identify anything in the room or any person in the room as OCD, really lessens the idea of the disorder. It can be a debilitating disorder. And by saying, oh, she's so OCD because she, you know, picks something on the table, it's really demeaning to those with the disability. You're so bipolar, or the weather is so bipolar today because it's rained and it's been sunny. Hear that a lot in Seattle. Again, it's demeaning to the person that has a disability. They don't choose to have bipolar, they don't choose to be manic and be depressed. You're so schizo. Or she's schizophrenic because she acts so crazy. I just want to think about the terms they're using, say what you mean what you say. Wheelchair bound. Saying this, you're saying that someone in a wheelchair, that's all they can be. They can only be in the wheelchair. Can't get out of it. So, wheelchair user, or someone who uses a wheelchair, ask the person if they would like to be identified. Are you deaf because someone didn't hear something? Are you blind because they missed something? These are said to people without these disabilities, not that they should be said to people with them. But you're saying that being deaf or being blind is bad. So my only suggestion to you here is don't do it. Ask them if they heard something or why they didn't hear it, why they didn't see it. Cripple. For the most part, we know not to use that word. Society has finally come to the realization that that's bad. But we use it in everyday language. Crippling debt is really horrible debt. So use that word instead. Otherwise, you're saying that being crippled is death. Suffers from. So you hear a lot from, like, suffers from schizophrenia. I suggest not to use this because it elicits pity. It evokes pity. So, oh, you poor thing, you have schizophrenia. It's so bad. So anything somebody suffers from. They're just, they suffer from the stigma of society with that disability, really. Differently able. How many people have heard this term or use it to, in terms of people with disabilities? Anybody heard differently able? As someone with a disability, I've always kind of been rubbed the wrong way about it, but when I spoke to someone, they explained to me why they don't like it. Everyone is differently able, regardless if you have a disability. We all have different abilities. So by not stating that I am disabled, you're not acknowledging the fact that the world makes me disabled. Society doesn't make everything with auditory options. So I can't see, but that would be okay if the parking meter had a button that told me what time and how much money to pay. Society is the one that disables me. I'm not disabled. We're all differently able. So by not acknowledging that I'm disabled, we're being part of the problem. Normal. My only suggestion here is to stop comparing abilities, stop comparing disabled to normal. We don't have a great definition for normal. And by comparing disabled people to normal, it lessens the person with a disability. Can you think of any other terms that are questionable to use?
Don't be afraid to say them.
You said insane, but, I mean, sorry, you said crazy, but insane is another one that's
right.
related. It's
just very similar to crazy.
For an insane amount of something.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, you might really mean ridiculous or absurd, but really then you're directing that towards the insane community, which is really just mental health community.
I think there's the, like, referring to things that can be gay or any
right.
of those sorts of things.
So, retarded. Anytime people said, that's so retarded. You're really meaning stupid. Very similar to when people say, that's so gay. Just say what you mean. Otherwise, you're making these words to describe disabled people bad. Any others?
Gim.
Yes. So, again, referring to someone with a physical disability, really, and meaning that it's bad. So, let's watch videos.
For the best of live music, entertainment, and comedy, the Emerald Queen Casino is the place to be. Mighty and Molly star, comedian Billy Gardell, Saturday, May 14th, only at the Emerald Queen Casino, the entertainment capital of the Northwest.
Their drivers told two blind passengers that the bus was full, and they had to get out.
Those passengers say they felt demeaned and discriminated against. And now they want all mentoring drivers to get better training. Steve Giggins has their story from Seattle.
What happened here at Pine and Broadway on Sunday afternoon, the couple told me that the driver claimed that the disabled section on the bus was full, and they have to get off and find another bus to ride, even though Metro tells me blind passengers are not required to sit in any one section of the bus.
I'm like,
Cindy Bennett and Mike Mello can't believe that a bus driver told them they had to leave the bus because the Americans with Disabilities Act seating section was full.
We were so shocked. It was such an uncomfortable situation. And the word I've been using is demeaning because, you know, we were literally told we weren't welcome on the bus.
Completely over the top, unacceptable.
Marcy Carpenter, president of the National Federation of the Blind of Washington, says this kind of discrimination should not be tolerated by any of Metro's passengers.
This driver should have a clear understanding that you never, ever speak to a passenger in this way.
Metro apologized for Cindy and Mike's experience, saying the driver provided poor customer service. And while Metro wouldn't go on camera, they did send a statement that says, in part, blind passengers are not required to use the ADA priority seating area. We've identified the operator and his chief and been working with him on this issue and will take appropriate action. Mike and Cindy hope the same mistake is repeated.
It's not okay for their drivers to treat passengers so that we're blind, sighted, or have any other disabilities in the manner. It's just not acceptable.
Now, Metro spokesperson calls this incident unacceptable, but also tells them to take the steps to prevent something like this from happening again by reminding all of their drivers about the proper procedures for helping their disabled customers. In Seattle, Steve Higgins, BBC and Fox News.
So I happen to know this couple, and when they got on the bus, there was plenty of seating in the back of the bus. It's not the ADA foldable seats section, but they were still told to get off because I don't know if the driver thought they wouldn't be able to get to the back of the bus, or if he's been trained to not let disabled people go to the back of the bus. But it's still discrimination because if they could have gotten to the back of the bus, which they could have, they're very able in that situation, then they should be allowed to do that. Make sense?
Yes.
So as a senior citizen, I have to sit in front of the bus?
Can everybody hear?
No.
Imagine a town full of physically impaired people, all wheelchair users. They're running. There aren't any able-bodied people, so naturally, when they built the town, the community decided it was pointless to have ceilings 10 foot high and doors 7 foot high. So the ceilings were built at 7 foot and the doors at 5 foot. In every way, they designed the place the way they wanted it. One day, a few able-bodied people come to stay. One of the first things they notice is the height of the doors. The reason they notice is because they keep hitting their heads. They come to stand out by the bruises they carry on their foreheads. Soon doctors, psychiatrists and social workers all become involved. Committees are formed. Many people are worried about what becomes known as the problem of the able body. Throughout the town there is a growth of real concern. Specially tough helmets are handed out free to the able body to be worn at all times. Braces are designed to give support and relief, while keeping the able-bodied wearer bent to normal height. Various groups of compassionate wheelchair users get together and form registered charities. Every quarter they have a collection day. Upturned helmets are left in pubs and shops for people to drop their small change into. There is talk of founding special homes. But then one day, it dawns on the able-bodied that there is nothing actually wrong with them, just that society excludes them.
We are there to inspire. And in fact, you know, I'm sitting on this stage, looking like I do, in this wheelchair, and you are probably kind of expecting me to inspire you, right? Yeah. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm afraid I'm going to disappoint you dramatically. I am not here to inspire you. I'm here to tell you that we have been lied to about disability. Yeah, we've been sold the lie that disability is a bad thing. Capital B, capital T. It's a bad thing. And to live with disability makes you exceptional. It's not a bad thing. And it doesn't make you exceptional. And in the past few years, we've been able to propagate this lie even further via social media. You know, you may have seen images like this one. The only disability in life is a bad attitude. Or this one, your excuse is invalid, indeed. Or this one, before you quit, try. Yeah. These are just a couple of examples, but there are a lot of these images out there. You know, you might have seen the one, the little girl with no hands, drawing a picture with a pencil held in her mouth. You might have seen a child running on carbon fiber prosthetic legs. And these images, you know, there are lots of them out there. They are what we call inspiration porn. And I use the term porn deliberately because they objectify one group of people for the benefit of another group of people. So in this case, we're objectifying disabled people for the benefit of non-disabled people. The purpose of these images is to inspire you, to motivate you, so that we can look at them and think, well, however bad my life is, it could be worse. I could be that person. But what if you are that person? I've lost count of the number of times that I've been approached by strangers wanting to tell me that they think I'm brave or inspirational. And this was long before my work had any kind of public profile. They were just kind of congratulating me for managing to get up in the morning and remember my own name. And it is objectifying. These images objectify disabled people for the benefit of non-disabled people. You know, they are there so that you can look at them and think that things aren't so bad for you, to put your worries into perspective. And life as a disabled person is actually somewhat difficult. We do overcome some things. But the things that we're overcoming are not the things that you think they are. They are not things to do with our bodies. I use the term disabled people quite deliberately because I subscribe to what's called the social model of disability, which tells us that we are more disabled by our bodies, by the society that we live in, rather, than by our bodies and our diagnoses. So I've lived in this body a long time. I'm quite fond of it. It does the things that I need it to do, and I've learnt to use it to the best of its capacity, just as you have. And that's the thing about those kids and those pictures as well. They're not doing anything out of the ordinary. They are just using their bodies to the best of their capacity. So is it really fair to objectify them in the way that we do, to share those images? People, when they say, you know, you're an inspiration, they mean it as a compliment. And I know why it happens, because of the lie. It's because we've been sold this lie that disability makes you exceptional. And it honestly doesn't. And I know what you're thinking. You know, I'm up here bagging out inspiration. You're thinking, geez, Stella, aren't you inspired sometimes by some things? And the thing is, I am. I learn from other disabled people all the time. I'm learning not that I'm luckier than them, though. I am learning that it's a genius idea to use a pair of barbecue tongs to pick up things that you drop. I'm learning that nifty trick where you can charge your mobile phone battery from your chair battery. Genius. We are learning from each other's strength and endurance, not against our bodies and our diagnoses, but against a world that exceptionalizes and objectifies us. I really think that this lie that we've been sold about disability is the greatest injustice. It makes life hard for us. And that quote, the only disability in life is a bad attitude, the reason that...
So I show this video because you see these memes on Facebook going on all the time, and the other social media that I don't really know of, but I would suggest not sharing them and sending them on, because you are objectifying a person with a disability. So the cartoon, which suddenly led us to this video that was also on my farm, like, so that was cool. Who are the disabled people in that video? Right, so it's not our disability that disables us, just like Sally Young says, it's the environment. News example of the inspiration porn that she was talking about. This article goes on to talk about how this blind man is so inspirational because he's shopping. And a lot of the article is raving about this grocery store worker who was helping him shop. And really, that's his job. And someone took this picture to objectify this man when he's just doing a daily thing that everybody does. It's shopping. So I encourage everybody to just look at the privilege you have and help those who are less privileged, not just who have disabilities, but in all categories of different privileges. We can't better this world and have social change without help from people of privilege. That's all I have for you. Thank you.
So if you were on the bus where they rejected the blind people,
yeah,
what could you do, or what should we do?
Well, I mean, my initial reaction would be to get really pissed. And I've learned that that's not such a good method. It doesn't get anything done. So big breath. And educate that driver. He just simply didn't know. Just ignorance. I don't know if I would have given up my seat because I do need the seat in the ADA section, but I would have certainly asked somebody to help the people to the back of the bus if they needed it, anything. Just education is the answer. Anything else?
Joining us today. I'm not sure if Anna has any time in the next couple of minutes, but as you are leaving and gathering your things, if you want to talk about the presentation, talk to Anna about anything, she's here as a resource. In addition, if you'd like to find any materials on the topic, we're happy to do that. And if everyone can pass in their simulators, that would be great.
I'm so sorry, I traveled here. I'm actually getting sick today, so I actually get quite a lot of what she said, and I'm afraid my phone, the volume wouldn't catch most of the information. Is it possible that if you give me an email, if you don't mind, send me the video, because I kind of need to use it for myself, and I can take it for next week.
Yes, I can run super blurry.